بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our salah and our siyam and our qiyam and our supplications and invocations and charity and all our ibadat. Ameen. Ameen. Welcome to yet another Dhuhr reminder in this blessed month of Ramadan here at the Melbourne Medina. We've moved the reminder from after Salat al-Dhuhr to this particular period between Iqamah and Adhan. It seems most appropriate, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Brothers and sisters, you've heard me speak to you all a lot about this whole, about the concept of introspection and self-auditing and taking account of oneself. Especially from the statement of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, when he said, حَاسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسَبُوا, that take account of yourself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes your account, before your deeds are studied, take some time out to study your own deeds. And this morning during my reading, I came across an amazing observation penned down by Imam Ibn al-Jawzi rahmatullahi alayhi, and I thought I share with you some of his observations as part of our sitting this afternoon in or within a title or within the title Food for Thought. Food for Thought, the only food you're allowed to eat whilst fasting. He says rahimahullah in his discussion of the delusion of a believer, he says that when we look at the Muslims, and this was at his time, a long time ago, but subhanAllah, there's definite wisdoms for us to consider in our times today. He says when we look at the worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we look at the believers, we find that they are those who are diligent in their worship, but whilst they are diligent in their worship, they are people who are proud of themselves, or proud of the worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed them to complete. Meaning, they have some form of self-amazement. And this is a contradiction. He says, when we look at them, we see from them those who have left many obligations and those acts of worship which are considered obligatory, yet we find them busying themselves with acts of worship that are considered to be voluntary, the nawafil. So they leave the fara'id and they busy with the nawafil. He says rahimahullah that when we look at them, we find those that recite the Quran a lot but rarely practice on that which they recite. And we find those who fast a lot, but they are unable to control their tongues. He says, rahimahullah, we see from amongst them those who go for Hajj frequently, but they do not leave the oppression of others. And they do not look at the sources of their earnings. And they do not consider the avenues of their spending. And they are those who leave their neighbors hungry. He says, rahimahullah, that from them are those who invite others towards goodness, yet they forget about themselves. And Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, was asked about this person who invites towards goodness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all, the speaker first and foremost. He was asked about a person who invites towards goodness but doesn't practice that which he invites towards. And Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, or radiallahu anhuma, because him and his father were from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in, he mentioned the ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَتَأْمُرُونَ النَّاسَ بِالْبِرِّ وَتَنْسَوْنَ أَنفُسَكُمْ. Do you command the people towards goodness and you forget about yourself? And he recited the ayah in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِمَ تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. He recited the ayah in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, why do you invite to that? Or why do you say that which you do not do? Indeed, this is something mighty with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you say things which you do not do. Imam Ibn al-Jawzi rahmatullahi alayhi says, I see people who invite towards good, yet they don't practice that good which they invite towards. And he says, rahimahullah, that I see people who pray, but they never ever aim towards studying the prayer of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the best way to pray. And he says that he saw those who frequent the Taraweeh prayer and the Tahajjud prayer. They frequent the voluntary congregational prayers, yet when it comes to the obligatory congregational prayers, they are absent from this prayer. And he says that I've seen those who ensure that they attend the majalis of al-wa'adh, meaning the sittings and circles where talks related to the purification of the soul take place. And those talks which you and I today called iman boosting talks take place. He says, I see people who frequent these types of gatherings, these gatherings that aim to boost one's iman and aims to soften their heart and aims to soften their soul, but rarely do I see them changing for the better. Subhanallah. Right? He's trying to say it's as if they've just come for entertainment. And this I've been discussing with some of the brothers, the whole nature of the da'wah in this particular century, this 21st century, and the differences between da'wah after the turn of the century and da'wah, for example, in the late 90s. The nature of the talks and the nature of the people who attended the talks. The talks in the 90s, for those who care to ponder, were talks that were or that had high academic content in it. There were talks that had high academic content. With the turn of the century, those talks don't bring people to the masjid. If you're teaching something with academic value, people rarely come. But general talks, talks which are quote-unquote iman-boosting talks, this is what gets the masjid full. But how many actually practice that which they hear? How many really become substantially boosted? And people who are diligent with the ibadah throughout the course of the year that they experience and witness, how many from these talks actually find this? And how many enter a slumber with the waking of the next day? They were boosted at night, they woke up the next day, shaitan said to them, greetings. And they were left with no tools to manage themselves and boost themselves, right? It's not sustainable for you to get somebody to change your car battery every day and charge your car battery every day or charge your phone battery every day. MashaAllah, everything has batteries nowadays. We don't need to talk about the car battery. That's an old example. Right now we charge our phones, we charge our watches, even the watches get charged. Right? It's not sustainable to get somebody to come charge your battery every day. Why don't you charge it yourself? They famously said, if you give a man a fish, he feeds himself for a day. But give him a net and he will feed him and his family for the year. Subhanallah. And I say, that's not enough as well. Giving him a net is not enough as well. Teach him how to make the net. Because one day he might have a hole in that net and he'll become stuck again. Right? So, when we look at the da'wah in the 90s, it was filled with talks giving people the tools how to build their nets. There were people who were able to self-motivate themselves, and we find from them those who were the means of starting up organizations and da'wah initiatives, even though they were not graduates from big universities in the Muslim world or Darul Ulooms and places of knowledge in the countries that they came from. They were not skilled in fiqh and jurisprudence and jurisprudic methodology. They were not skilled in the sciences of theology. They were not skilled in matters pertaining to the Quran and tafsir. Yet, they instigated the startup of many platforms that graduates from Islamic universities and Islamic institutions could enter and do zakah of the knowledge which Allah gave them. Meaning teach the knowledge which Allah gave them, because the zakah of knowledge is to teach it. Just like the zakah of wealth is to spend it in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Ibn Jawzi rahimahullah is citing a very pertinent point and something for us to ponder. This halal food for thought whilst you fast. He says, I see many who attend these sittings, iman boosting sittings, but many really grow from the sittings that they attend. He says, rahimahullah, that I saw many who give charity but continuously involve themselves with riba and riba transactions. They give charity by night and by day they are signing riba contracts with riba institutions. He says, rahimahullah, that I see those who are good to their parents, but they eat up people's property. They are not trustworthy with that which people have entrusted them with. And he says, rahimahullah, that I see those who sin, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I see those who sin, whilst there are those who remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I see those, what he's trying to say is, you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but that remembrance doesn't pass your collarbones. It hasn't entered your hearts. It hasn't stopped you from sinning. It hasn't taken you away from that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has considered disobedience. And he says, rahimahullah, that I find those who sin and use as an excuse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. And they forget that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that His punishment is severe as well. Indeed, food for thought. My dear brothers and sisters, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from being in a state of heedlessness where we live our life in this world thinking we upon goodness, thinking we upon the path of those that are destined for Jannah, whilst in reality we're not. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Wallahi, the worst thing is to realize on the day of Qiyamah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us realize before He takes us back to Him. Ameen. Hatha wallahu a'lam wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayka.